Good morning slash good afternoon, my fellow audience. Welcome back to another sermon brought to you live from Seattle, Washington. My name is Antonio, for all those who don't know, and for all those who are watching this for the first time. We are about to jump into the final conclusion to our relationship series. But first of all, I just want to thank everybody who's been participating, for those who've been reaching out to me and wanting to connect and to fellowship and to grow. Because honestly, you know, and the whole concept of my whole meaning behind this whole series was helping people to identify healthy things, the pros and cons of a relationship, and the pros and cons for being single, and the healthy things that we are supposed to do or should be doing while we're in a relationship, or if we're married, or if we're even looking to, or for a partner to be serious with. Before we get to in today's message, first of all, we're going to do our victory confession. It's just our declaration, knowing that our best days are still ahead of us. And for all those who've been watching and for the tuning in, you guys already know the victory confession. For all those who don't know, for first timers, just follow along with me. Just do me a favor, lift your hands high in the air, as high as you can, just repeat after me. I'm here on purpose because I have a purpose. My heart is open, my mind is ready to receive because God is not finished with me yet. My best days are right in front of me, and I have victory in my life because Jesus lives in me. And all those declare, say amen, amen. And honestly, you know, my thing is this. We have to be able to declare victory over our lives. We have to declare victory in our relationships. We have to declare victory in our lives. Because how else are you ever going to live a successful life if you don't declare a successful life? And my thing is this, that having a healthy relationship is mostly important. And this is part of our relationship series, is having a relationship healthy. And that's something we've been talking about for a long time right now. And my thing is this, the whole concept of asking ourselves why is a relationship healthy is a fundamental thing I think a lot of us ask ourselves every single day. And this particular last part number five, the title I've given it today is How Couples Work Together to Glorify the Union Before God. Now, my thing is this, just think about the title there for a minute, How Couples Work Together to Glorify their union before God. Because God did not bring two people together without reason. He doesn't do anything without reason. Everything God has done for you and has allowed to happen in your life was for a reason. And if He delivers you a man or a woman, and he does it with reason. He doesn't do it just because he just thinks he wants to do it and play, you know, puppeteer. No, he does it for a reason. What we do with the gift He's given us is up to us. But the fact that He's given us something is up to Him. So before we get to in today's message, we're just going to say a quick prayer. Thank you, Father God, for bringing us to another day, message, Father God. Thank you, Father God, for allowing us to celebrate Father's Day, Father God, not only to honor our earthly fathers, Father God, but to honor you in heaven, Father God. Thank you for allowing us to give us the strength and the courage and the wisdom to seek your face, Father God. Thank you just for allowing us to pour out this message to my audience, Father God. Thank you for putting all this stuff on my heart, Father God, so I can share it with my brothers and sisters, Father God. Let this word be heard, Father God, not me as a speaker, Father God, but let it glorify you, Father God, as the eternal speaker that speaks from the beginning of time, Father God. Let us find peace in your word, love in your word, grace in your word, forgiveness and understanding, Father God, how we seek your face and not your hands, Father God. Let us come to you boldly, Father God, knowing that we are incomplete without you, Father God. And help us better to understand relationships, Father God, knowing that the first step to having a healthy relationship is with you, Father God. Thank you, Father God, for just allowing us to be here in your presence, Father. We welcome you in this place and forevermore, everywhere and anywhere we're at, Father God. We thank you, we love you, we appreciate you, and we give you all the glory. Because you are the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Father God. We thank you, we love you, we appreciate you. In Jesus' my name we pray, amen, amen. So we're going to go ahead and dive in. I got a lot to cover today, so please bear with me. It will be a little long. So for those who can't sit for more than 15, 20 minutes, whatever, you guys are more than happy to, you know, pause it and come back if you want to. Or you can just watch half of it one day and watch the other half of the day. It's just up to you. So, but it's all important information. The reason why I say it's important information is not because I wrote it, reading it to you. No, it's because I feel that in order to have a successful life, to have a successful future, and to fulfill your purpose that God put you, you have to have a successful life and in the art of relationships. And that doesn't just mean relationships as far as dating. No, that means relationships with people in general, whether it be a coworker, a friend, a family member, or a spouse. It doesn't matter. Relationships is important because Father in heaven teaches about how relationships with Him is more important. Because why? Because if we have a relationship with Him, if we understand Him, if we continue to seek His knowledge and His instruction, then handling a relationship to Him on earth should be easy. So let's go ahead and dive in and see what the Lord has put on my heart so I can share with you guys. Okay, so let me start by saying we have a fun series so far, and we had a great fun series. It's been very inspiring, it's been very encouraging, but it must come to a close. So let's recap a bit for those who haven't seen part 1 through 4. And in part 1, we discussed the questions is having a relationship healthy? And I gave some insight on how being in a relationship has better results than being single. And in part 2, we discussed how there's 17 different signs that show that a relationship is dying or already dead. And in 3 and 4, we tackled what men do wrong in a relationship and what most women do wrong in a relationship and what can destroy a relationship. So in part 3 and part 4, we kind of talked about what the men tend to do to destroy a relationship. And in part 4, we talked about what women do that can destroy a relationship. But we must ask ourselves, what does God want for our relationship? That's something we have to ask ourselves every single day. Who are we meant to be with is another question we tend to ask ourselves. How can we work as a team to ensure our success? And I'm about to give you 5 points. 5 points to get a grip on your relationship. So you get a grip on your relationship, not just with your spouse, but with your kids, with your coworkers, your bosses, your siblings, with everybody in general. And real quickly, briefly, we're gonna have 5 of them. The art of knowing, the art of listening, the art of waiting, the art of forgiveness, and the art of openness. So let's dive into the first one, the art of knowing. We're often told that it's important to know thyself. Although this advice might sound a bit easier said than done, it turns out that knowing who we are makes a difference in our romantic relationships. This general sense of feeling like I know who I am is referred to as self-concept clarity. Past research suggests that people who feel like they have a clear sense of who they are tend to be more satisfied with their romantic relationships and more committed to their partners more than being selfish to themselves. I found that there are certain times when having high self-concept clarity is especially important in relationships, and that our relationships can in turn shape our self-concept clarity. Abundant research suggests that when we change, they feel happier with their relationships when their partners support that change. So meaning that if you're constantly changing and improving your life, if you're becoming a better person and the other person's not supporting it, that's usually a good sign that's a very toxic relationship. Why? Because they're not supporting growth. Because God's word is, even though God's word is the same, but it encourages growth in Him. And a lot of people don't understand that concept. Now, however, less is known about what predicts whether a partner will be supportive in the first place. Are certain types of people especially likely to support a partner's change? That's a question we have to ask ourselves. We have hypothesized that people with low self-concept clarity might actually seek to undermine their partner's change, meaning that those who are not clear in themselves will always tear down those that they're with. Why? Because they have no clarity of who they are within themselves or with God. Why might this be, you may ask? I found that people with low self-concept clarity resist having experiences that could change their sense of who they are. I found that people with low self-concept clarity worry that if their partner changes, they will also have to change. Unfortunately, their lack of support for their partner's change erodes relationship quality. I followed some participants for 9 months, and I found that those with low self-concept clarity undermine their partner's change over time. Mean that some people who don't want to change, they actually can either hinder or slow down or even stop the other person's growth. Why? Because they feel that they don't have to need to change. They feel that wherever how they are now is sufficient. And guess what? You should never live a mediocre life. You should never be satisfied with who you are. You should always be continuing to increase your knowledge and growth, because as you increase your growth and your knowledge, you become better, stronger, faster, wiser, more clear thinking. You're less to anger. You're more prone to love and not to hate. So change is not a bad thing unless you make it into a bad thing. Now, for example, if their partner had decided to pursue art, they were more likely to make negative comments about their partner's painting or schedule other activities for the two of them at the same time as their partner's art classes. This lack of support resulted in their partner feeling less satisfied with the relationship and less committed by the end of the study. And it was not only the partner who was unhappy with the relationship, the person who had undermined the change also felt less satisfied and committed. So people with low self-concept clarity and tended to undermine their partner's change because they were worried about having to change themselves. But this made both people feel worse about their relationship in the long run. And this is something I studied for the last couple weeks. It was really important and very crucial because I couldn't just live off my own perspective. I couldn't just focus on my own personal testimony. I had to go out and see it firsthand. Knowing oneself is important for relationship dynamics. But do relationship dynamics also influence how well we know ourselves? And that's a question a lot of us have to ask ourselves. In other study I did, I examined how the ways people relate to their partner's influence, their self-concept clarity. A theory suggests that people vary in the ways they think about their relationships. And individually high on attachment, anxiety tend to desire extreme closeness with others but fear rejection. Whereas those high on attachment avoidance tend to distrust others and are hesitant to become too close to others. Certain individuals in particular with low levels of both attachment avoidance and anxiety are said to be securely attached, although past research that I examined has explored how attachment anxiety affects the self. Less work was examined whether attachment avoidance might adversely affect the people's sense of who they are. And some people tend to battle who they are and who they need to be. And sometimes you can only really find out who you're meant to be in God's word. That's the only way you can really, really, truly have a healthy relationship and make the union that God brought together into a strong one. Attachment avoidance might be critical for self-concept clarity because of the ways that we understand who we are is through other people knowing us. If evident individuals fear intimacy, their partners may not know them well enough to give them self-affirming feedback. Thus, we hypothesized that avoidant individuals might experience lower self-concept clarity because they are less likely to get the kinds of feedback from their partners that affirms their sense of self. In one study that I found that I brought couples into the lab and directed each partner into a separate room, I then asked them certain questions. To list 10 answers to the questions of who am I and who is my partner. Some common examples responded included funny, caring, worry. This enabled us to see how well people really knew their partners. How many items on the partner's A list is describing themselves showing up in partner's B list describing partner A. I found that most of the partners that I talked to of avoidant individuals really did not know them as well as the partners of less avoidant individuals, and this turned particularly lower self-concept clarity. And this just drew me to make a second study because I had to really figure out why. Because a lot of people think that in the art of knowing, you have to be on a continuing learning basis. You have to continue growing every day. You have to continue learning about them every day because you can learn something new every day. And if you come to a point in your relationship with somebody and you're not learning anything and you think you know everything already, then you're wrong. That means you're not really paying attention. That means you're dropping the ball on the relationship, and we have to be able to get it together. In the second study that I did, those who were more evident at the beginning of the study reported later on that their partners did not know them, which in turn predicted lower self-concept clarity. Taken together, this set of the study suggests that knowing yourself plays an important role in relationships. People who feel like they know who they are tend to be more supportive when their partners are changing. Likewise, the types of people who are comfortable with being close to their partner tend to have a clearer sense of who they are as a person and who they are with God. So perhaps it's worthwhile after all that to really know who you are or who we are, both ourselves and for our closest relationships. Because without knowing who you are, without knowing who you are in Christ, how can you really be in a successful relationship? The Bible says that man dwells with the woman according to knowledge. Knowledge, the art of knowing, not assumptions. Knowing in order to you who you are dating or married to, you must know not only yourself, but them as well. It's a continuing growth process. It can't just be a 1 month or a 2 year process. No, it has to be a lifetime purpose. The whole process of saying I do means you're going into a lifetime commitment of getting to know that person every single day. The scripture tells us in Hosea chapter 4 verse 6-7, the scripture says this: my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge because you have rejected knowledge. I reject you from being a priest to me, and since you have forgotten the law of your God, I also will forget your children. The more they increase, the more they sinned against me. I will change their glory into shame. So my thing is this: when you reject knowledge, you are welcoming shame. Even though there's no shame in the word of God, but you're welcoming shame because you're shaming yourself. Because why? Because you are rejecting God's knowledge. Lack of knowledge will always hurt a relationship. It will always disturb a union that God brought together. Why? Because without knowledge, how can you grow? How can you understand without knowledge? How can you grow without asking questions? It's crucial. And the scripture reminded me in Proverbs chapter 24, verse 5, the scripture tells us this: a wise man is full of strength, and a man of knowledge enhances his might. Meaning to me is that strength doesn't come from your muscles, okay? It really doesn't. Strength comes from the knowledge and wisdom you have acquired over many years of studying who God is, and who you study who Jesus was and how he modeled his life, what he did with his life. This is what true strength is in a man and in a woman. And my thing is this, before I go into the next topic, is that you have to be able to chase knowledge more than you chase the sinful fleshly desires, because the flesh will always lead you astray, but the spirit and heavenly realms will not. So next we're going to talk about, the next is the art of listening. Listening strengthens relationships and demonstrates attentiveness, caring, and respect. Listening is more than just hearing, however. To truly listen, you must give your undivided attention and put your own agenda and needs aside. For many people, being able to speak without interruption is like a release. This style of listening focuses on building emotional closeness with others. Relational listeners are attentive, friendly, and aim to understand how the other person feels. And relational listeners tend to be more non-judgmental and aren't interested in controlling or evaluating what is being said to them. And here are some tips for becoming a better listener. This goes for both men and ladies, okay? This is not just talking just women. This is not just targeting men. This is something how we all should be doing to be more effective in our relationships. Because then how can we glorify the bond that God brought together if we're not willing to listen? Number one, put yourself inside the mind of the speaker. Don't just think of it just from your perspective. When you're listening to something, put yourself in their shoes. It'll better help you understand why they're really upset. It will give you more clarity to the underneath reason why they're upset. Listen for meaning. Meaning that don't just listen to the attacks that they're attacking you or attacking something you're doing. Don't just listen to the anger. Listen to the emotion behind it. Because there's always a deeper reason why people are upset. Pay attention to the body language. Body language is key. Body language can tell you if enough is enough. Body language can tell you if they're getting overly frustrated or they're getting ready to shut down. It can give you warning signs for those who tend not to be able to control their abusive nature. Cultivate empathy. Take the time to understand, empathize with them. Try to get into their feelings, their heart. Feel the heart is where it's going to help you better understand them as a person. Avoid making judgments. Very crucial. Never judge someone for having the right to feel how they feel, because it can only make it worse. My personal favorite, look into the other's eyes when they're speaking. Eye contact is very important. That's the one thing that used to make me so mad when I was in the dating world, because I hated it when a woman would not look at me when I'm talking to her, because it felt to me it was so rude. So it's very crucial, guys. And for you ladies out there too. Because I know a lot of women, they tend to look at the wall or the ceiling or whatever, and they just forget all the concept that their significant other is speaking to them. Pay attention to the feelings associated with the words. Meaning, don't focus on the words, associate with the feelings that's behind the words. Notice the speaker's tone and inflection. Repeat in your own words what someone has told you. Empathetic reflections. And lastly is acknowledge that you are listening by nodding or saying uh-huh or yes. Because the number one thing that can frustrate somebody is that they feel like you're not really paying attention. And occasionally summarize others' comments when you given the chance. I mean, if they say something to you, then give them some proper feedback and summarize it with some brief comments that's positive and encouraging and acknowledging. Thirdly, we're going to look at the art of waiting. This seems to be the most difficult task for men and women. Waiting is so difficult for a lot of us, because a lot of us lack patience. I can't imagine that there has been a time when humans enjoyed waiting. Perhaps there was a time when we had a much greater capacity to wait, but that doesn't mean that waiting was ever a positive pleasure. And you know something that I thought of is that, you know what I like best? To wait, said no human ever would never say that. Waiting entails waiting for something, and it is the something that we are after, or maybe it's something that we are trying to avoid. The something could be something horrible, but waiting for something horrible, it happened, doesn't make waiting any easier or any better or even healthier for any people who suffer through anxiety. The problem or reality is that life requires a lot of waiting, a lot of waiting. Like, you can't rush a woman into sex. You can't rush a woman into a relationship. You can't rush her to be ready to commit. You can't rush her into the ways of the Lord. You have to give patience, and you have to give her that comfort knowing that you are there and that you're waiting for them. And ladies, you can't rush a man to be super successful. You can't rush him to be a better lover in the bedroom. You can't rush him to do anything that he's not ready for at that time. You have to show patience, because the Lord is patient with us, so why can't we be patient with each other? On an ultra-cultural level, it's mostly waiting that makes people upset. You turn the soil, plant the seed in water, or you wait for the rain to fall from the sky, and you keep the pests, weeds, insects, or animals away. Then your harvest, when the plant grows to maturity, the harvest is the goal. But no one wants to wait for it, and sometimes you have to wait because sometimes the best things in life is worth waiting for. But between planting and harvesting, no matter how much activity is happening and helping in the meantime, you are still waiting, okay? So something has started, but it is not yet complete. The same goes for birds and the bees. Between conception and birth, something is happening behind the scenes. Cells are splitting, bones are solidifying, organs are growing, nerves are sparking. But however much the mother is tending to herself and her body, the process happening within her happens over time. This consists of giving birth. The only instant plants in children are plastic. Anything that requires growth requires waiting. This principle applies especially to the soul. Inner transformation, development, growth, integration, consciousness, and creativity takes time. We have to give ourselves time to grow. In fact, it is difficult, if not impossible, to see where any of this process even actually come to an end other than death. And for every culture and society prior to our own, death wasn't even considered an endpoint. It was thought of more like winter, a season with an ongoing cycle of degeneration and regeneration. There are plenty of spiritual traditions that found in death a test and a trial of waiting, like waiting for spring, waiting for a decay and dissolution of death to complete its work and finally clear the way for new life and development. And that's something that it took me a long time to even come up with that concept, simply because when you're born, your knowledge begins at that point. You begin the process of learning from the moment you exit your mama and get on that doctor's table, and you get the little spanking on the butt. You have been started your knowledge of growing. Are you conscious of this time? No. I think most kids nowadays, depending on their development, depending on their parents, you know, how they operate as far as raising them, you really don't really start really slowly integrating what you're learning until you're at least about maybe 6, maybe 7 months, you know, because for the most part, from my own limited experience, is that when you're an infant, you're all about, you want attention, you want to be pain, you want your diaper changed, you want to be fed, you know, all the normal things that come with having a child. But there's so little that you're taking in that you can actually remember and still process. Because me, personally, myself, I don't remember anything below age 15. I remember some bits and pieces of my life. I remember some chaotic moments. I remember some stress environments. I remember certain events, but there's so much I have already forgotten. And so, how can I put it? So, in some ways, we are always in a state of in between, consistently moving from beginning to ending to beginnings. Even when we are most active, our actions are taking us towards something that is not yet, that we have to wait for our activities to reach or to complete. So we ask ourselves this important fact or question. So how do we work with waiting? What do we do with it? Attempting to avoid it only means that we still stunt or stop our own development. Next, we must ask, how do we live with it, or maybe even serve it, like waiting on waiting? After all, nothing seems to happen without stars would have nothing, have never formed if God didn't put it into existence. If God never would have thought it would never exist, life would have never evolved, communities would have never developed, or a culture would ever emerge, nor would have art ever been created without waiting for the atoms and the molecules to congregate, for DNA to stack and spiral, for thoughts to form, for language to sound out, for clay to be hardened, for colors to be mixed and paint to dry. So every process, everything that's out there had to go through the waiting process. We always had to wait for some type of development. You had to wait for your wife to conceive. You had to wait for your child to grow, to learn how to walk. Everything requires waiting. And we live in a society where everybody wants it right now. They want this right now. And that's not how it works. We have to enjoy the process of waiting. I know it's hard, but humans weren't around to wait for the most of this to happen. Nevertheless, it all took time, a long time, that just the inherent nature of things seems maybe the nature of God. Why God? For the sake of alchemy, God said, okay, I made that up, but I blasphemed for a sacred purpose that perhaps this, wrap your mind around this, perhaps more than any other practitioners of ancient arts, the alchemists instantly deliberated and deliberately participated in waiting as an integral element of the sacred art of transformation. And what does that mean? Alchemists were devoted to discovering the inner divine nature of things because they wanted to participate in the ways, in the way of nature works. They thought of the nature as the intimate of the alchemy artist. If nature can draw a seed to split and sprout and flower, they wanted to learn how they could cultivate themselves, germinate, and to grow to completion, which is, it's another confusing aspect, because when I was researching and thinking about it, it was so many things even I didn't quite understand. I had to really dig into the Word of God to really grasp the concept that while they were working in their laboratories with the metals and acids and minerals, they were searching for nature's patterns. And guess what? Some things you won't know until you ask the Father in heaven. There's some things you would never ever understand until you ask your Father in heaven. That's why, because He has all the answers. Whether we're journalists, therapists, psychiatrists, biologists, you know, geneticists, or whatever title you have or whatever you study, won't give us the ultimate answer of why things are the way they are, because only God can give us that answer. And within, we're seen as expressions of the same normal. Alchemists considered humans as inseparable from nature's art, and so they thought there might be an art to developing nature in human form, one that involves reflection, contemplation, imagination, since these kinds of consciousness seems essential to contemplation of nature's planning, of the human soul, basically. You can never grasp or understand that human soul unless you understand what your soul means to you, what it means to God, what it means to your purpose in life. Alchemy is not chemistry, in which the outcome of a chemical operation is independent of the inner disposition of the person doing the work. In alchemy, the kind of person we are within, the content of our consciousness either corrupts or improves the outcome. For the human work of art, for the human as a work of art, nature requires a contribution of our consciousness to complete the picture. What we contribute from within, the quality of what we think and we feel and imagine, is something extraordinary, and we have to be willing to enjoy the process of waiting for it. We have to enjoy the process of waiting. Waiting is an overall fact. Waiting is the key. Waiting is the only best thing that we can do for ourselves to help our reflection and contemplation, and to help our imagination grow and to seek greater knowledge. When we're waiting on our consciousness is working, contemplation, painting within, soul making, mixing into our life, the hues and the tones of our moods and the attitudes, we're covering our inside with brush strokes of hope or despair. We're stretching the unknown with a dark apprehension, or coloring it with anticipation, which a lot of times some of us get so overly worked up with the art of anticipation of great things to happen. We throw caution to the wind when we see a red flag and we do nothing about to correct the action itself. Now, to me, this is something that's very important, that I think it's very crucial, that waiting forces us into our own inner gallery, into a viewing of the styles, qualities, and contents of our own consciousness. That is why we are so often trying to avoid waiting, because facing the mosaic of our own minds can be disturbing and depressing. It's difficult to look directly at our anxieties and insecurities, abandon callings, and betray ideals. And to me, that's something we need to really understand, because at the end of the day, we can't rush the process. We have to be willing to enjoy the process to know who we are. Soul making is an art. The alchemy of art of waiting. That's something we have to do, and that's something that we learn in God's word, is that waiting is crucial. It's for our benefit more than it is anything else in this world. Next thing we want to examine is the art of forgiveness. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 to 15, the scripture says, "For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." That is God's word. How can you say yourself a Christian? How can you say yourself a believer? How can you expect to operate in forgiveness if you can't forgive other people? How do you expect to receive forgiveness from Father if you can't operate that way? And In John chapter 6, verse 37, the scripture reminds us this: all that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. Meaning that you should never come to a point where you choose to not to forgive somebody, because when you choose not to forgive somebody, you're choosing to hang on to some type of animosity or resentment or bitterness that can potentially turn into anger, frustration, and eventually maybe cause you to lash out to that person, whether it be your boss, coworker, siblings, spouse, or whoever. And it would tend to have some negative consequences. At least I believe that's to my perspective. And my thing is this: when it comes down to the art of forgiveness, we have to be willing to really bite down hard and say, you know, what's worth it? Is our waiting for them to forgive us worth it? Or, I mean, because you can wait for forgiveness, but you should never have to wait to give forgiveness. If that makes sense. You should never have to wait, because forgiveness, the art of forgiveness is key. And T.D. Jakes wrote a book called Let It Go, which is a very powerful book. I highly recommend it for those who haven't read it. For all those who follow T.D. Jakes, he's a very popular pastor who really speaks the word how it is. And it's very fundamental fact that we understand the concept of the art of forgiveness, because you can't have a successful life if you're constantly hanging on to things that people have done to hurt you. You just can't do it. It's like you're killing yourself with your own poison. Lastly, we're going to talk about the art of openness. People who tend to be high in the trait of openness are more willing to embrace new things, fresh ideas, and the novel experiences. They are open-minded and approach new things with curiosity and tend to seek out novelty. They tend to pursue new adventures, experiences, and creativity endeavors. Openness is one of the most five personal traits of the Big Five personality theory. It indicates how open-minded a person is. They are imaginative, curious, open-minded. Individuals who are low in openings experience would rather not try new things. They are closed-minded, literally, and they enjoy having a routine. Now, there's something wrong with having a normal daily routine. You get up, you pray, you have your praise and worship, have your coffee or your lattes for some of you ladies out there or whatever. Whatever you do, routines like that are not bad. But always be ready for when God throws you a curveball, when God throws something into your routine to disrupt your routine, to get you to see the bigger picture. You can't be so complacent and do the same things every day. Now, there's some things you can do every day, like your prayer and your Bible reading study. That's recommended. But there's oftentimes you have to adjust maybe where you read, how much you read, if you meditate afterwards, for how long you meditate. You always have to think of different ways to help elevate. Because sometimes when people get so pointed, just like a routine like this, I'm reading, okay, this scripture, okay. All right, and then they move on about their day. No, you have to put a set time to really dig into it and to really understand the concept of what God's word really is and what it really means and what it should mean to you. Because at the end of the day, as I get the keys to come up, you know, the whole concept of God's word is important, and you have to be willing to meditate on it. Meditating on God's word is essential to growth, because you can't just read the word. You have to be able to meditate on it and pray to God for a revelation. You have to allow him to help you manifest something in you so you can grow. And resolution is key. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 to 17, the scripture tells us this: all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be content, equipped for every good work he does. Now, to me, that says to me that God's word is breathed into us every day. Every time you read the word, hear the word, study the word, meditate the word of God, whatever, or you have to be able to allow it to... Well, how can I put it? There is profit in the word of God, but you have to be able to have an open heart and open mind to see the profit in it. You can't just read it and say, okay, is this another scripture? No. Every scripture has a promise to your life. There's over 700 promises in the word of God, and there's quite a lot of them that has to do with your particular situation or you particularly as a person. And in resolution itself, that second Timothy that tells us all about resolution. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training. I mean, the word of God in resolution is to correct, to help motivate, and to train people up in righteousness. That is the word of God. Now, let's talk about resolving conflict. Now, when it comes to relationships, when you're in a relationship, if you want to resolve a conflict, you have to go to the word of God. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 13, the scripture tells us this: bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must be forgiven. You have to be, in order to resolve a conflict, first of all, you have to get to a point of understanding the fact that whatever happened, happened. And you have to get to a point of understanding why it happened. So that goes into doing the first three. The art of listening, the art of waiting. And did I already forget that already? Yeah. So those are two things you have to really practice in the initial part. It's the art of listening and the art of waiting. Because if you're not listening, how are you going to understand? So you have to wait for them to communicate with you. And if they have a hard time listening to or communicating, it's your job to be patient. And that's because they are waiting. You have to be patient with them to let them talk freely. You have to give them an opportunity to be able to show that they can communicate, but communicate at their own pace and their own level. So that's what it means to me when it comes to resolving conflict. Lastly, peace of mind. What does it mean to have peace of mind? The art of openness and the art of forgiveness will help you have peace of mind. Those two concepts alone will always help you. In Psalms chapter 23, verse 1 through 6, the scripture says this, a psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pasture. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me into paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Just imagine how powerful that is. Let's break it down a little bit. The Lord is my shepherd, means the Lord is my rock. The Lord is my everything. I shall not want, means it means I should not succumb to selfish desires. He makes me lie down in green pasture. He gives you a sense of comfort to where you are being still in the midst of chaos. He leads me beside still waters. He gives you a breath of fresh air. He leads you smoothly like a subtle stream on an ocean floor. In a relationship, you have to be able to be still. You have to be able to practice all five. The art of listening, the art of waiting, the art of forgiveness, the art of openness. I mean, you have to be able to, you have to be willing to practice these five things. Because if you can't practice these five things on a daily basis, you're in big trouble. Because the art of knowing is the most crucial thing. The art of listening is it's a must. The art of waiting is a given. And the art of forgiveness is where you're going to find the most peace at and find that peace that you're looking for is the art of waiting. Because how you're ever really going to grow, how you going to ever grow your relationship, how you going to glorify the union that God has put you together with the other person if you're not willing to wait for that growth process. Now, my thing is this. I don't mind waiting as long as I see it's coming. If I see a woman hurrying, that tells me conscious, she's aware that her making me wait is putting me in a strain. So, and the consciousness of it is encouraging. But when I see that she's not doing anything or not moving at all with any purpose, that's what frustrates us as men. That's just what frustrates me. And I'm pretty sure it goes the same for you ladies out there. When you see a man who's not doing his part to grow as a man, who's not doing his part to help make the house stable, it's frustrating. Because you're waiting on them to help, but they're not helping. Oh, and I can see that can be very frustrating to a lot of us. And last time we ended here in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, the scripture tells us this, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now to me, that says a lot about him, because the peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, which means we have peace, we have the opportunity for peace and salvation through the blood of Jesus. We have been healed by the stripes of Jesus. So we have to acknowledge the fact that the art of knowing can often mean that if we're not willing to know our partner, how can we be in a union with them? If we're not willing to continue, and the art of knowing goes beyond just the first few dates, where you get to a point, you have date one, date two, date three, you spend time together, you meet family members, you have sex and all that. No, knowing means so much more than that. The art of listening, you have to be willing to listen to each other. You have to be willing to communicate as well. The whole aspect of communicating is listening. Listening is way more important than actually doing the talking. Now, if you find yourself in a one-sided relationship where you're doing more of the talking, the other person's just like the wall, and that's where you had to have a serious conversation with them and question their commitment to the relationship. Doesn't mean they can't change. Doesn't mean they can't improve. But you need to know where you stand. Because even I have been in relationships where I talk and talk and talk, but it doesn't do no good. Why? Because it's like they're listening, but they're not really listening. And then nothing frustrates this person who wants understanding to somebody who feels that they're not being listened to. It's frustrating. Very frustrating. So in this message, I know part of this was a little confusing. I know part of this message was a little out there. I had to dig into a lot of different research. There's a couple things I had to jot down in notes that even I myself still have to go back and pray for more revelation on it. I hope you guys found patience with it. Hope you guys found it encouraging. I hope you found it inspiring. At some point, I probably will have to redo this particular topic because there was so much that I understood, but there was even more that I didn't understand to the full extent that God wanted me to. So I hope this message encouraged you. I hope it gave you a better insight on the five things that we need in a relationship, because as a man and a child of God, the art of knowing your partner is crucial. You can't support the union that God put together if you don't know who you're dealing with. The art of listening, if you're not willing to listen to your partner, then you've already caused a dismay to your relationship that God put together. If you're not willing to wait on the growth process, if you're not willing to be patient with your partner, then you are causing more frustration to yourself because you're putting your own self in a stressful state and filling your own self with anxiety and fear and worry and anger that you don't have to, because if God's patient with you and you're a sinner, why can't you be patient with your spouse? Fourth, the art of forgiveness. You have to be able to respect the fact that if somebody offends you, somebody rubs the wrong way, you have to be willing to give them forgiveness because God forgives you. And you do just about as toxic and sinful things as the person you're probably with. Now I get it. Some people say, well, what if he cheats on me? I can't forgive him. If he abuses me, I don't forgive him. If he molests or if he kills or he steals, I can't forgive him. Sin is sin. There's no sin greater than the other. I'm sorry. Sin is sin. We all have the capacity to forgive, but it boils down to choice. Lastly, the art of openness. Being present in the moment is important. You cannot have a successful relationship and you cannot use your relationship between now to glorify God if you're not open. Ladies, if a man's being 100% transparent with you, if he's telling you that girls are trying to talk to him, they're trying to do this, but he's doing this to say, no, I am in a relationship, don't take it as far as he's beating you up and saying, oh, these girls are after him, he thinks he's so good. No, he's communicating with you because it's a struggle to be a faithful person. And let me tell you why. Because there's some things, there's some people out there, and there's some women out there, and some men out there who won't do things that other people will do. And the whole part of getting to know someone is knowing what they can do versus what they will do. And everybody has the capacity to do anything they want to, but it comes down to choice. Sexual compatibility is not as important as spirituality compatibility. You must be spiritually and emotionally and mentally compatible before you can even be sexually compatible. Just because a woman's good in bed or a man's spectacular in bed doesn't necessarily mean they're right for you. That's just one part. There's so much more that makes a relationship grow. And this is what's going to end our series. This is what's going to bring the end in conclusion, because a lot of people think having a stable relationship with money is more important. Some people think having great intimacy, great sex is important. Some people think having this is more important, materialistics or whatever. No, what really matters is the fact that you know that you both want to follow God's law. You want to embrace God's law and you want to do your best every day. Will you be successfully perfect? No. Will you make mistakes? Yes. But asking for God's grace and forgiveness is a must. So I'm going to end it here in prayer before I share something with you guys. I would like to close out this series with something powerful, something that it reminds me that, you know, the word of God is absolute. Whatever I say in my personal opinions doesn't matter as much as what God says about me. Because what God says about me and what God says about you is way more important than what we can ever say about ourselves or other people. And if you found this message encouraging, if you found it inspiring, if you found this sermon to be something that you could relate to, then reach out to me. I would love to hear your feedback. I love to fellowship with you. I love to talk to you. I love even to meet you, and we can fellowship, we can talk, and come to an understanding of who we are as individuals and who we are to each other. Because the whole aspect of preaching the word of God is spreading it out to the world. And my thing is this: we can't grow if we don't fellowship. We can't learn if we don't inspire others to grow. And if you find this message encouraging, please like, share, and subscribe to my channel. I'm always trying to upload new things, new material at every given moment. And I'm always happy. You guys can either find me on Facebook. I do my stuff on Facebook on my daily scriptures. And then I try to upload something on my YouTube channel every chance I get a chance. But most of all, just share the message. this message may not help you directly, but it may help somebody else. And we're all about helping people here at Victory. I may not be the Victory Church itself, but I represent the victory that God put inside me, because I serve a God who, above all, brought me to a church that taught me about what victory really is, what it should mean to me, and what it should be to you. And I encourage you guys to really take the opportunity to listen to the Word of God, to love each other, and to continue to move forward. So for those who are listening, for those who are watching, I'm going to say a quick prayer before I share this song with you guys. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are our creator. You know us better than anyone else. You brought us together, and you have promised that you have plans and a purpose for us, plans to prosper us and not to harm us. Remind us that you are the center of our relationship, and that you are the one who watches over our future. May we look to your wisdom and guidance. May your peace, which surpasses all understanding, guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Lord God, our builder of all things, we ask that you help us shape our conversations as we discuss the important parts of our relationship. Empower us to continually share our past experiences, faults, fragilities, opinions, spirituality, and our hopes and our dreams, Father God. We thank you. We ask for your help us to be real about who we are and expect our love ones to do the same. Guide us to explore the topics we need to explore with our transparency and openness. May we be enriched through the process and grow deeper in intimate understanding of each other and you, Father God. We thank you, Father God, for the message that was delivered today, Father God. We thank you, Father God, for just allowing us to be in your presence. We thank you, Father God, for the words you put in my heart, Father God, so I can relay it to them, Father God. Let it be found on open-minded and open-loved ears and hearts, Father God. Let everybody's mind and heart be open to your word, Father God, and your counsel and your correction and your instruction, Father God. Let your wisdom be something that surpasses all limitations, Father God. Know that we can do nothing without you, that we're nothing without you, and we cannot do nothing in this world without you, Father God. In Jesus' my name we pray and we thank you, Father God. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. Again, I hope you guys enjoyed the message. Honestly, you know, it's the best thing, I think, in our lives is just knowing the fact that we are created in God's image, that we were created to be like Jesus, that we were created in God's image, but we were meant to imitate Jesus. So again, if you guys like this message, please feel free to like and share. And like I said, I look forward to fellowshipping with anybody, everybody. That's why I'm here. I'm not only here to promote the love of God, but I'm also here to fellowship with all my brothers and sisters, whether you're in Florida, Alaska, Uganda, Europe, Asia, doesn't matter. We're all part of the same body, and we have to acknowledge that. So I'm going to share some with you guys. It's called Word of Life by one of my favorite praise and worship leaders, Jeremy Kapp. I do not own the rights to this. It's very powerful. I love it. I hope you guys enjoy it. Word of life, speak to my weary heart, strengthen my broken parts, lead me to your open arms. Word of truth, illuminate all these lies, the enemy speaks inside, in freedom I will rise. 'Cause you call me out from the grave, so I can live like I've been changed. Take me where I wasn't safe. I will not be afraid.